Hey guys, welcome to Electronic Dance Money, your number one business resource for making money as electronic musicians and producers. Alright, sweet. So this is episode 3 of Electronic Dance Money, and my guest today is Alberto De Casa. We're here today to talk about branding, and you, for your business, you are a mixing, you're an audio engineer. You also do some recording for metal bands, stoner rock, but lately you've been doing mastering for EDM, which is awesome. I love that.
Right. I started mastering, and it's weird because I've been getting all sorts of requests. Like, I've worked with indie electronic bands. I've done some EDM. I got to master a record that Timbaland produced. That's all hip hop, and you know, I've never worked with hip hop before. Like, that was really interesting.
That's crazy. That's gotta be. Yeah. What was that like?
It was super odd because. So I wasn't contacted by him personally. Basically, how it came through is it came through some manager friends of mine. They just told me, like, hey, there's this record. You know, you master our stuff. You want to give it a shot, see how it goes. Just, you know, one quick thing. Timbaland mastered 4 of the songs, and you're supposed to match his other productions to his masters. I was like, well, sure, let's do it, you know. So they sent me one track to kind of test it and make sure that, you know, I knew what I was doing. Side note, I'm completely oblivious to hip hop. Like, I don't follow it. I grew up in Mexico, like, was completely ignorant of it, you know. Like, I know the most basic stuff. So anyhow, they sent me a song. I master it. I was all nervous, like, I hope I kill it. Like, it sounds great, but, you know, and I have some references, and my wife grew up with more hip-hop than I did. So I just went to her at night, and I'm like, hey, dude, so I had to master this song. You know, is this artist called Neo or something like that? It's just like, what? Yeah. She's like, just go to Spotify and look at how many plays he's got. You'll shit your pants, basically. I was like, oh, okay. So that's when it hit me, like, oh. This is serious, you know, it's not.
And when did you do that? What?
It just came out. So what it is, it's a series that YouTube and Lionsgate put together. It's called Step Up, High Water. It's the second season of that series. And they're trying to do like a throwback to 90s and 2000s hip hop R&B kind of scene. So Timbaland produced the whole soundtrack, and he had a bunch of different artists coming through. And he makes and master 4 of the songs. There are 9 of them. One of them was an instrumental that this chick made. She's done a bunch of movies and stuff, like, you know. So it was completely. It definitely opened my mastering business, like, to, okay, well, now I can do soundtracks, I can do hip hop, I can do R&B,
That put you on another level too, to be like, yeah, I mastered one of Timbaland's tracks. Like, if you can put that kind of name on your site. And people can recognize. I mean, that's insane. So, how did they find you? How do you get connected like that? Because I feel like I am so far beyond that. You've been in this industry for how long now?
12 years.
Really, yes. Professionally. So you've put your work in. You've put in your hours to kind of earn that kind of work. But how does someone just find you like that?
So for that, it's like you say, it's paying your dues and putting the hours. It didn't come from me hustling. It basically came from me nurturing relationships. So I've learned there's a lot of opportunities like that that don't come through, you know, an artist that's looking for stuff. At those levels, it's all their managers that are doing the dirty work, and their labels that are, like, you know, the A&Rs are just looking for stuff. And they're the ones that are usually suggesting stuff for the artist. A lot of the times they're not even involved. Like, I'm sure on this one, you know, like, they weren't even aware of who I was or what was the deal. They just shoot it out to some people that they knew that could get this job done. And they're just like, okay, just send us a track and make sure it sounds good. And if it does, you're good.
That's crazy, man. I mean, I can't imagine getting... If I got a name like that on my desk, I would be freaking out, almost to the point where I would probably be like, I don't know if I should do this. I don't feel like I'm qualified.
I was definitely terrified, for sure. I was like, this is insane.
Can you kind of tell me a little bit more about your story, about how you got into this realm of mixing and mastering? And I mean, you're starting to dip your toe into mastering for the electronic side of things, but I mean, you're in a completely different genre, but you've taught me so much just over the past like 6 or 7 months we've known each other, which is why I wanted to have you on the episode. But I would love to hear more about your story, about how you got started in the industry, and I'm sure more people would like to get to know you a little bit more.
Yeah, definitely, man. So basically, when I was a kid, like every other kid, I wanted to be a rock star. And my parents were terrified of that. So their idea was like, well, you know, let's get him a couple jobs. And at first, I was trying to get random jobs. Like I work at a car shop and stuff like that. And I was just so disinterested. And one of my dad was doing production gigs. Like he puts together like big shows and, you know, those events that like fashion brands put together, or like an auto show in Mexico. So he got me with him one summer, and he's like, hey, here, go intern for him, you know? And I talked to his friend, and his friend sat me down. He's like, well, if you want to do music, like I can do anything for you here, you know, but I have a friend at a studio that I hire that's literally across the street. So we can go there and see if they'll take you. So I went there, and that was definitely a game changer for me. That studio was more post-production, and they were doing a lot of, like, the only music they managed was really music for commercials. So, and they do a lot of stuff for radio, but they didn't really have a music production side to them. It was more like editing and putting together stuff. So I get a gig there. These guys kind of gave me a different vision, you know. They were like, learn about recording yourself. That might show you something different of you as a player. And I just immediately fell in love with recording. Side note, I was always really good with computers. So this was like a really good marriage for me of like technology and music. So at that point, I was like, yeah, this is it. You know, I want to do this shit. So I moved to America and I went to college here for audio engineering. While in college, I was supposed to get an internship. And I was just going through my favorite records, like where can I work? Like let's see what producers I can hit up or do anything. So I was looking at Lamb of God's Ashes of the Wake and Sacrament, right? And I see this name Machine. And I'm like checking him out. I'm like, oh, this dude is like right around the corner from me. Like it's the next town over, you know. I'm sure he'll never respond to my stuff, but I just did some digging online and I found him. And I got the email of his engineer at the time, which was Will Putney. And Will just immediately replied to me. He's like, yeah, they'll jump on a call, you know, come down to the studio. We'll see if you want to intern here and whatnot, if we're a good fit. So I go to the studio and take the interview that every single intern through there gets. And there's a line of like four of us. And I mean, we immediately connected. It was pretty cool, especially Will and I. Like I was like, yeah, you know, we're cool. So at that point, I just started shadowing them. For me, it was a big deal to be working with producers that do the bands that I like.
Right.
So I wanted to go the extra mile and make sure they needed me at all times. So it just started going through the ranks there, basically. And the way that those guys work is like you wouldn't get paid until you can show a skill. They'll teach you whatever you want, but you can sit there for as long as you want, but if you're not editing vocals, you're not getting paid. If you're not editing drums, you're not getting paid. The studio is always open when they're not using it. So that was another thing of like, yeah, go out, find some bands. You don't have to charge them. You don't have to give us money. Just make sure nothing breaks and, you know, learn. Like, we need you to learn because there's a demand for the way that we were working. Like, at some points, it was insane because we will do pre-production with bands and then basically, like, I'll get the bass player or a guitar player in a room and Machine will have the singer in a room and we'll be, you know, there'll be another engineer editing drums in the back and everybody's just going full throttle to get a record done, you know? So it's like, it was very fast-paced.
It's extreme. I was just about to say, yeah, it's got to be very, like, you're on your toes. You got to make sure everything's running smoothly. You're on time frames and budgets, definitely. All that.
And I mean, those guys, you get fast there. Like working with those guys, it's crazy. We shred on keyboards. And
well, that's what's important about this industry too, is like an audio engineer is how fast can you get things? What's your quality of work and the time frame that you can get that quality finished?
Definitely. And the time frame also came from how the industry progressed, you know, because you used to get huge budgets where you could take 3 months to do a record. And now it's shrinking. And if you want to make a profit, you better do it in a couple weeks.
So. Well, and that's exactly what how electronic music is too. I mean, the time frame at which producers need to put out tracks is getting smaller and smaller. I've got a buddy who puts out he can finish a full track from start to finish, producing, mixing, mastering, in about 4 or 5 hours, and it is a high quality track that can get released on like the biggest labels. And that goes hand in hand with the technology. As the technology has progressed and gotten easier and cheaper, you're able do it at that kind of fast pace.
And I remember very vividly this moment where we had an intern. He comes in. He was way younger than me. And immediately, like, I knew this guy could shred. Like, you know, he shreds on circles around me. Like, he's crazy fast and really talented, great songwriter. His name is Zach Cervini. I don't know if you're familiar with him.
No,
so
he
produced the last Blink 182, 5 Seconds of Summer.
Jesus.
Yeah,
he was your intern. Wow.
Well, he wasn't my intern. He was Machine's intern. But yeah, we worked together. We did a couple of records together. He's such a sweet dude. He's in LA. But yeah, at that point, I was like, oh my God, like I need to get my chops up, you know? Yeah. This kid is incredible.
It started to like pick up the pace a little bit.
Like quickly was like a reality check. Like, there's people that are crazy good at this and I need to get on it too. And a week after I started, Randy LeBeauf came. He's Will's engineer. He plays in a band called Tradewinds too. So, I mean, like Randy and I were basically the two interns that from that period, like stuck out and really put the hours and put the effort to keep going up. And at some point, this was in New Jersey. So at some point, Machine wanted to move to Texas. And that's when I was like, you know, that sounds cool. Austin sounds cool. I'll come down with you. We'll make studio. And I was his engineer at that point already. So, you know, it worked. So we came down here. We did a Clutch record. We did a couple metal bands here as well. And it was kind of like the pace over here was different. And I got an offer for a record to pretty much work at a record label. So that was like, cool, you know, this might go somewhere good. The idea was to have a record label that will have its own studio as well. So I saw there was potential there. And with Machine, things weren't, like, he was going back to New Jersey and it was like slowing down. The studio ended up being in Dripping Springs. So for me, it was hard to bring bands over there.
For anyone that doesn't live in Texas, from Austin to Dripping Springs, that's like what, an hour?
Yeah, it's roughly an hour.
Yeah.
But the biggest problem, especially at that point, because now there's hotels and all this stuff, but at that point, it was hard to bring bands from out of state because they'll have to stay in Austin and rent cars or, you know.
Right. There's an issue with all of transportation. That where you're staying, you're going to have to pay for your hotel, plus you're going to have to pay to rent a car, plus all the gas. Plus insurance on the car. Like, there's a lot of stuff.
And food and stuff. Like, in Jersey, it was pretty easy because everything was walking distance. And, you know, we had a place for the bands to stay there. So the model for me wasn't working here. And I was living at an apartment. Like, I didn't have a rig to record with. Like, I just have my editing rig pretty much. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to give this record label a shot and see what comes from it. And that was when I was like, okay, I can probably get this studio with just mixing and mastering started. At least it was mixing at that point, because mixing was my strong suit. And for some reason, the bands that I work with, they never had a budget for mastering. It was always like a bundle. Even whenever I was recording, it's like, yeah, you're doing everything start to finish. There was only a couple, like with Zach, I had a project that he mixed it and mastered it, and there might have been a couple, but mostly it was like, you do everything.
About a year ago is when you kind of launched your own studio for yourself, where you're kind of taking on your own clients.
Like, formally, yeah. I've been carrying that since 2015 when I left Machine. I've always been taking gigs. But it was more like whatever falls on my lap. You know, I was not going out of my way to find stuff. And because it's, you know, because of the records that I work with, like, the credits are out there and people will just look you up and hit me up. So I had a website that was terribly done and, you know, just get a couple of things here and there from there. But, and also from all the relationships that I was forming with through the label. It opened a lot of doors, just meeting producers and meeting A&Rs and meeting managers and everybody. There is where mastering became really important for me, because everybody needs a favor when it comes with mastering. And that's something that I can do in 20 minutes and send their way. And here you go. Like, it's not a big deal. I'm not going to lose 3 days of work doing this stuff.
I love that story. The reason why I wanted to have you on today is because you have completely transformed my entire world about how I see myself, my business as a brand, and how to market yourself as a brand. But knowing what I know now, I mean, the shit I was doing before was just stupid. None of it made any sense. Nothing was consistent. And so that's why I want to have you on today, to kind of explain your process of how to determine these kinds of things, and especially for producers in electronic music, because as a producer in electronic music, it's a one-man band. You're doing everything. No one is giving you handouts. No one's really looking for you. You've got to do all of the artist development, all of the promotion. You're doing all of the creation. A lot of producers do all of their own mixing and mastering. So they're, you know, they're doing everything. And when you start out as a producer, you're not taught how to brand. You're not taught how to do artist development. It's
a necessity.
And, yeah,
that's why you learn it.
It is a necessity. And a lot of producers don't even know what to look up or what to do about. I mean, they just kind of get stuck in this haze, and they get stuck in the mindset of, if you build it, they will come. Which is completely not true. No one is fucking looking for you. No one cares about your music, and you have to get it out in front of people in order for these record labels to start looking at you. I mean, there's a lot of different stages to marketing and branding. There's a lot of things you got to do to get things in, you know, get that process going. When I started, I set up all my social media profiles, and I wasn't posting too much for a couple months because I knew, like, there was an algorithm, and you don't want to start until, like, you're dedicated. But when I did start posting to social media, and I focus more on Instagram because it's such a bigger market there, and there's so many producers on there. But when I was posting, I mean, I was just kind of posting what the fuck ever. Nothing that really told you who I right. was. And
for those who are listening that don't understand the branding concept, let's put it this way. Your business, let's say it's an artist, right? And their branding is their songs. Like, what genre are they singing? What's their voice? Have they found their voice? And I think, like, whenever we talked about your Instagram, it was like you were an artist that had no voice yet. You know, you were doing open mics where whatever cover they asked for or whatever landed on your feet, like, sure, we'll do that. There wasn't, like, a thought process behind, like, oh, people are going to connect with this post because of this.
I was completely oblivious to that. And after we talked, I started to think about, oh shit, I'm about helping people out. So why don't I, and I think it was like my most recent post was some tip that I shared, and you're like, you should be focusing on that. And I started kind of to reevaluate things. I go, oh my fucking God, I need to be posting about tips and tricks on Instagram. And I started to do that, and immediately I was getting twice the amount of likes, twice the amount of, everything just started falling in place. Ever since I started doing that process about 4 to 6 weeks ago, I've grown like almost, I'm almost over 100 followers, true followers, since that happened. And that's just within 4 to 6 weeks. And my studio has been open for a year, and I'm at like 253,
right,
I think, as of now.
And that was completely organic too. Like, you didn't pay for anything.
Oh yeah.
It was just literally improving your content, and here people are showing genuine interest.
That is all it was. And, you know, going further into my brand, that's what this podcast is about helping producers, helping them monetize, and this being a business resource for them. So I figured it out in that moment. I mean, just within like 30 minutes of talking to you, I realized, oh fuck, I know what I need to do. Time to get to work and start organizing everything. And I think that is the first step into branding yourself, is determining what is your brand. Who's your audience? What are you trying to achieve? I think that is the very first step you need to take.
Right. It's going back to that. You're an artist. You found your voice. Okay. Who's going to like your voice? And now we're going to see what those people do. Like, for me, a big thing, for example, was I thought social media was not the place for me as a business, because all I was doing was Facebook. I even tried to run Facebook ads and whatnot, and like, sure, all my aunts will like my stuff, you know. I had a page, I think it has like 400 or 500 likes for the producer stuff, but it could never really get separated. Even though I have a lot of friends on Facebook, there's just not really targeting the right people. My audience was not active on Facebook. So my thought was at that point was like, oh, so I guess social media is not my place to market. I should try something else. What really hit me was last Thanksgiving, I was sitting with my sister-in-law and she's showing me. So she runs all the marketing and the social media for the Oklahoma Aquarium. And she's been growing it like crazy. Like you will think for an aquarium, I was like, what? Like they already passed the 10K, I think, on followers on Instagram. And like she's killing it. And my thought process was like, well, how many people are in Oklahoma that care about an aquarium? It's crazy because it's bringing people in the door. So she sat me down and she was like, well, here, let me show you a little bit of this and why you should do it. And it immediately like blew my mind. Oh my God, I've been targeting the wrong people, you know? I was doing what I thought I should do and not what my audience was asking of me. And it makes so much sense too. So I've been looking at statistics and all this stuff, and young people have moved towards Instagram versus Facebook. My audience are young musicians, and those guys are all over Instagram.
Same here.
Their age, I mean, like,
it's crawling. It's unbelievable the amount of activity. Like you were saying before with Facebook, my target audience is on Facebook, but getting to them is the hard part. Instagram, completely different story, is so much easier.
Dude, 55% of millennials are on Instagram. Just let that sink in. Whatever you're selling, they're there. Unless you're selling products for people that are like 50 and over, your audience is in Instagram.
It's not even the fact that they're there, but they're looking.
Yeah,
they're
active.
Not just there. They're going into hashtags and looking right. Just at tags and scrolling for hours through there. So they're there and they are looking for that stuff. As a producer, they're craving that music, and the millennials they're all about electronic music right now.
Right.
So if you have the right hashtags, just looking for your track, your minute-long clip of your track playing, they're looking for that on Instagram.
For sure. And not just the hashtags. Like, there's so many ways around stuff. I guess we'll get more deep into it as we keep going through our app. But yeah, it's just really learning how to use the tools that are provided in Instagram to really get to these people, you know?
So what's, can you kind of give me an explanation? What process would you go through to determine your goals? Really determining your brand, which goes right into determining your goals. I mean, the first step is to figure out what do you want to be at the end of the day in 10 years.
So the first thing that I think of it is, this is like a ladder. You can't jump to the top step and just be like, oh, that's what I need to do, you know? This is like as dumb as I heard bands like, oh, we gotta do this stuff because Lady Gaga's doing it. I'm like, well, sure, you can try.
You also
that.
Don't have 10 million followers.
Exactly. What you need to do is see who is the next step away from where you are. Just go online and start looking. If being Chrysler Algae is your goal in life, well, who's younger than that and who's doing less than that? And then from that guy, who's younger than that, or who's the engineer for that person, and what is he doing? So you can set goalposts. For example, if I was going to give you that thought process, like I could go, well, I'm not going to go Chrysler Algae style because that dude, like, there's just no way you're going to compete with that. Whatever he posts, people are going to like it just because he has the name, you know? What is somebody in my niche that is doing great? Okay, what is Dan Corniff doing? What is Will Putney doing? And then, okay, well, that's interesting. I don't have a super fancy looking studio to show, or I don't have the artists that they have that are going to attract people. So how do they get there? Who's the next guy? Sam Pura is a producer. He's based in San Francisco in the Bay Area. His studio is called the Panda Studios. And he's
that's such a good name. Yeah. Oh my God.
And he's like the perfect brand. Like, he's got logos, he's got his gear is branded, he's a character. Like, he's definitely somebody that I look and I go, wow, he has all of this together and he does it so good. It's so natural to him. His Instagram and his following. And
I do want to clarify too, just for the listeners, so Alberto, like we said at the beginning, he comes from more of a rock background. And that's why he's kind of naming off these names, but you can apply everything he's talking about to producers in electronic music. I'm telling you now, especially if they have a big following and there's big names behind them, they have gone through this whole branding process. So if you don't recognize some of the names he's talking about, pick any big name in the industry and step down from there. Take the ladder, start with one person and walk your way down. And this actually goes right into what we were talking about in the previous episode with Cameron about finding a mentor. When you're finding a mentor, it's the exact same process. Think of the mentorship as a ladder. You're not going to step to the very top. You're not going to start. If you're a producer who's been producing for 3 years, you're not going to fucking go up to Skrillex and be like, mentor me. That's not how that works. You're going to start at someone who's just above you, who can teach you some things. It's the same thing with branding. Look at someone who's above you, who's, you know, still relatively small, but they have a big enough following and you see that they're starting to brand themselves and kind of look at what they're doing.
Yeah, and I will say don't not just contact those people. I will say don't ask them for a job. If you ask them, ask to offer something. I found that in this industry, people are approachable and, you know, everybody's is cool and they get it. You know, as long as you come from, you know, you're not entitled. If you go and say, hey, I really love what you do, can I sit on one of your sessions? They're totally cool with that most of the time. Look at a DJ that is maybe from your area or who is one step above what you're doing and they're doing something right. And even if it's not in your genre, like there's one guy on Instagram that I absolutely love. He's got a great following and he's making everything good. His name is Colt Keperon. He's in Nashville. He's a country mixer and he does guitar sessions. Really awesome how he shares his processes and what he's doing. And he's very personable. Like he's one of those guys that makes you feel like you know him, even though you've never crossed words with him. So like, I look at people like that and I go, okay, this guy gets it. That should be my next step. What is he doing that is connecting with people? And so my next thing I do is target their audiences. So I know what my brand is. I know what kind of people are gonna like my stuff. So I'm gonna do my homework, go to different accounts that are doing these things, and then figure out which of those accounts are gonna share an audience with me. It's not that hard to find them. Like when we started talking, remember I showed you like, oh, you should check out these two accounts. Like they're doing something similar and like they're doing it so good. Still like an artist. Read that book.
And this is something that I mentioned in the previous episode with Cameron as well, is Steal Like an Artist by Austin Kleon. Steal Like an Artist. It's like $7 on Amazon. Get it. I mean, it is just phenomenal. And we dipped into the book a little bit about what it teaches, and a lot of it has to do with taking from multiple artists. You see what they're doing, you grab a little bit from each one of them, and you've now created something that's original and different, and you're not really stealing at that point. It's you've created something original and that's your own, and you're not reinventing the wheel either.
No, that's just how you form your voice. Like,
yeah,
I feel like right now there's so much of a stigma to doing that, where if you look at like classic bands from back in the day, like Bob Dylan, he did cover records for the first couple records before he even put anything out that was, oh, I'm Bob Dylan, you know. Metallica had a record with just covers before they were Metallica, and it was just not looked down upon. It was part of the development process of an artist.
It still is too. It's right. I mean, that's how you get inspiration. With most producers, how it starts off when you're starting out in electronic music is you have this idol, this huge producer who's massive in the industry, someone like Skrillex or Diplo or dead mouse or Hardwell. I mean, you've got these crazy big artists and you're like, I want to be that. I want to do that. What are they doing? How can I mimic their music? Let me try mimicking it.
Right.
But then usually at some point someone comes along and goes, oh, this sounds too much like this artist, or you can't do that. Or you read somewhere on some bullshit fucking thread that you can't be copying things from other artists, because it's just a terrible stigma that producers really need to get rid of.
I mean, like you said, Skrillex, that dude came from first to last.
Yeah, he came from a fucking metal band.
And not just that, like he was a great programmer for the metal band. I knew a producer that worked with him, and he told me, like, yeah, he was crazy with doing all the synth sounds and all this stuff. If you listen to the first Skrillex records, they're metal breakdowns.
There you go, dude. I mean, he's taking from a different genre.
Yeah, and you know, completely making it his own and just rebranding it, like, hey, here, check this out.
Well, then you get what comes out of doing stuff like that? You get the modern dubstep sound that Skrillex innovated and fucking blew up. I mean, 2008 to 2010 was all, actually 2008 to like 2012 was all about Skrillex.
Yeah,
everyone heard the name Skrillex, whether they liked the music or not.
Right.
They heard a track from him. And I mean, despite your opinions on him, he fucking blew up dubstep. And I'm sure a lot of his shit came from metal music that he was taking.
Yeah, I mean, definitely. If you think of it like metal breakdowns is where everybody, you know, gets a groove and bobs their head. That's literally what he was doing with all those songs. And
they all fucking headbang to it.
Yeah, exactly. And it's so crazy how famous he is that I remember thinking, so if you ever watched those movies, The Hotel Transylvania, like the cartoon one,
I've just seen bits and pieces.
Well,
but
so there's like a talent thing, right, in there. And there's literally, they drew Skrillex playing with synths on there for like 3 seconds, and you immediately know who he is. Like, they didn't have to say anything. It's like,
nope.
That's when I thought, like, wow, that's crazy. That's success right there.
That's fucking branding too, dude.
Yeah.
He branded a fucking haircut.
Yeah, there you go.
He branded a haircut because he made something unique, different in music that people loved and that he could sell out stadiums with.
Right.
And he kept a haircut and he branded that shit. Listen, you're not gonna have something that's top of the ladder. It's exactly what you were saying, like band saying, well, we're doing this because Lady Gaga's doing that.
Right.
You're not gonna get Skrillex's haircut just because he's got that haircut and it works for him. It's not going to work for you, because you know what everyone's going to say? Oh, you got a Skrillex haircut. You got a Steve whoever haircut. That's not what it is. So it's a process. It is a slow process that you build up from.
Yeah, it's more of a thought process, like what you need to draw on the board. Like, you can't see, for example, Steve Aoki throwing a cake to the audience and say, oh, maybe I should bake some cakes and throw them to the audience because I'm going to take that for him. You know, it's more about, oh, he's making an event that's going to be memorable in the middle of a song. How can I do that? And make your own. That's what you need to steal. And that's the core of copying somebody's branding.
Steal the idea, not the actual action of what he's doing. Like,
right. Like, go for the thought process.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. You don't want to steal the cake idea, but how can I steal the idea, stand out from the rest, and make my events that memorable? How can I get people to want something thrown at them? Not necessarily that you're going to throw something at them.
Yeah, but
but when people go to Aoki's show, they're like, I want to get a fucking cake thrown in my face.
Right, exactly.
If you go anywhere else, you don't want that happening.
Right. And I'm sure that even that dude, he was probably like watching Blumen Group, and he was like, oh, people like shit getting thrown on them. What can I do? You know?
If you're big enough, people want to see that kind of thing happen.
Right.
Let's go back over the steps of determining your brand. So I'd say the first thing is to look at your idol. What are they doing? Now step down the ladder. Who's below them that's doing something? And kind of just work your way down until you have someone you can follow, and look at their audiences.
Right. And I think also there's different steps that you need to take within copying those guys. So, like, in my head, for example, whenever I saw how I should grow my Instagram, it was about, first I need to do what am I posting? It's like a content review. And it's all about creating the model of, this is the blueprint of how we're going to move forward with my content. Forget about what strategies you're going to use, whatever. Just like, this is, put some lines around what you think your content should be, and sure, it will evolve, but at least give yourself a guideline. Then the next thing is growth. You got to think of, who can I target? Who can I show this stuff, and what are they liking? So that maybe I can grow. Like what we were saying, how can I make my post more engaging? And that's where you're at right now. Like I'm getting, people are noticing this stuff. And that's because you shifted your strategy to, here, I'm going to give them something that is useful in their careers and that is visually appealing for them. Because at the level you are, you can't just post your fucking breakfast and people are going to like it because, you know, because you are you. I'm sure if Skrillex posts whatever he's having for dinner, he's still going to get thousands of likes from people that will like anything he does. But for you, that's not the case yet. You got to stay true to your brand and make sure you're targeting the people that are right. The core of growing that is three things. So one is that make it interesting for them, right? Instagram's algorithm is insane. It got to the point that it has image recognition. So it's doing like it has an AI where it analyzes the picture you put up and it thinks like, oh, many people are gonna like this, or you know what, this looks sketch. So what that means for you, for example, I target mixing engineers or recording engineers because I want their business. I know that they like pictures of gear. There's millions of pictures of gears online. So I'm sure the AI has already figured out what shiny things with knobs are and who to target to. So I know if I post a good picture of my shiny knobs and things, people are gonna get it because there's interest and there's a demand for that. And the algorithm for Instagram is a monster that is demanding content, right? So make it interesting, number one. Number two is relationships. You're trying to target new people. So whether you use a software to follow people or based on what they like, who they follow, or you do it organically. For example, we're saying you have the lather, go to the next guy, see who's liking the posts of stuff that are relevant to you, and start following those people and see who follow you back. When you start interacting with these people and they engage with your posts and comment and vice versa, you comment on their stuff. So you build relationships, right? And those relationships is what Instagram sees as like, oh, this is going to be good because it wants that. It wants people engaged in it, in its app.
Do you follow Gary Vaynerchuk?
I don't know.
This is something that he talks about and people struggle on a daily basis that they always ask him, how can I build a bigger following? How do I get people to my page to see me? And one thing he talks about is, okay, well, you want people to give to you, but what are you giving back to the community? Because that's what it's about. I mean, with social media, it's about being involved in a community. And so he talks about how you should be going to, I think he said, go to 9 different hashtags that you post about and comment, sincerely comment something you like about their picture and like it on 9 different posts on 9 different hashtags. So you're going to 81 posts per day, commenting, interacting with people, and immediately your followers will start increasing. People start liking what you're talking about. And especially if you're in a specific niche, in a specific hashtag, your name starts to get recognized because there are other people that are following those hashtags and they follow them. Every day they're looking at those hashtags. If they start seeing your name every day and you're being sincere and talking about the posts, they're going to get curious about who you are and they're going to click on you. Even if you don't even follow them, they're going to see your name. They're going to go to your page. And if you have stuff that you're talking about and posting about that are involved with that hashtag that actually are involved with that, they're going to give you a follow back and they're going to start interacting with your stuff.
The other thing that's interesting about that is that's the whole plan, right? You want to get people to your page. And it's not just like, I want to get people to my page to like stuff. I want them for one big reason, and that's have your website on your page. Have who you are. Like, number one step before you do anything, you know, we're talking about make the blueprint. Make a bio that is 15, 20 words tops and says exactly who you are, what you do, and what you want. Make sure there's a website there or somewhere where they can look for and talk to you, you know?
For a lot of producers, I think that would be something like even if you have your Spotify link on there, but you should have in that description, I'm a producer for this genre. Don't fucking put some bullshit like, I make noises all day in my bedroom. Like, say who you are. I'm a producer. I make this music in this genre. And then below that should be a link to your music so that people can go listen to it. There's that DM message if they do want to get into contact with you.
Yeah. Or the worst one that I absolutely hate is when they put emojis and it's like flower, mushroom, alien, and then, you know, Virgo or whatever they're doing. It's like, oh, get out of here.
We're talking about branding here. In branding, there's a sense of professionalism within that, unless you're someone like Dylan Francis. Do you know who Dylan Francis is?
I don't think so.
Oh, man. Go fucking follow his Instagram. It's hilarious. He does nothing but comedy stuff. He's a massive producer.
Oh, yeah. I know who he is.
Yeah. It is. And I mean, he can do that kind of stuff.
Right.
But it's because he has that following. And before he could do that stuff, because he wasn't doing, I mean, I think it's just within the past 3 or 4 years that he's been doing heavy comedy stuff, just because he kind of fell into that brand. And people can't do what Dylan Francis does because, I mean, it's Dylan Francis.
But I mean, look at his Instagram. That's like the perfect example. It's dumb, but it's so well curated. His picture is there. He just says, I just want to make you dance and laugh. And his stories are just like ridiculous stuff of his mustache, his eyes and ears. Like, it's well done. You know, sure, it's a joke, but he's a comedian. He can do that.
He's known for that. That is his brand. Comedy is a great way to reach a lot of people and get a good following. But it's got to be done right. It's got to be done with high quality stuff. And if there's not at least like 30 or 40 people that watch your video that laugh and share it with someone, it's probably not a good brand to start with. You might just get more of the cringy factor. And if that's the case, you're going to get way more hate than love, and your brand will crash hard.
Yeah, it's all about curating who you are and what you're doing. And if, you know, like for me, it's Instagram. I had to give some stuff. Like, I'm not going to be posting, you know, my Christmas present or whatever. It has to be a sacrifice to, like, this is what my audience wants to see. If I want to share something personal, sure, we can do once in a blue moon, but it's not what my audience is here for. If you want that, like, maybe create a separate Instagram just for your business and have a personal one where you can do that stuff, you know?
When I go through artist development with producers, because actually I have one that I'm working with who's an amazing photographer. His name is Matt Combs. His photography is just incredible. And so he was struggling with trying to figure out, well, I don't, like, should I have a separate page for my artist and then have my personal page where I do all my photography stuff? And I go, well, I mean, it's really a preference. At that point, I was telling him, you know, it might not be a bad idea to combine the two, because people love photographs, especially amazing ones. And if you can combine your artistry with your photography, you've got a fucking brand that you can really build on, and you can be recognized as, and if you actually become a touring artist, people aren't just looking for the music you're putting out. They're looking for the incredible photos that you're posting every day from around the world. And that can get you a massive following. And I mean, with that, people are going to love your music just because they love you. If they love some of your work, they're more than likely going to love the other stuff. So let's get a little bit into the next topic, which would be, if you figured out your audience, you've determined what your brand is going to be, now you need to determine what kind of content you're going to create for that brand and that audience.
Right, exactly. I mean, you got to figure out what you're doing and what you're selling and who's doing that. So, as I was saying, like, just find people that have your audience and start creating relationships with them. You know, don't pester them. Like, I hate the thing where whenever somebody follows you, immediately you get a message back like, hey, listen to my SoundCloud link and go like my stuff.
Fuck that. Nope.
Like, you want to have it organically, you know, let them show interest. Like you were saying, it's a place for you to share your art and also share your process and who you are as an artist. Randy Blythe, the singer from Lamb of God, is really good at it. He's amazing at photography, but he basically shows you like, hey, here's my band Lamb of God, here's my photography stuff, and here's what I enjoy as a person. And fans love that because it connects them with him. But again, he's at a bigger level.
Yeah, you're not there yet. Post your process. If you're working on a track, you can post that. What are you working on in the studio as a producer? Sure, post about that stuff, but don't post about you walking your dog and shit. People don't want to fucking see that. They do want to see your process. If you're going to post anything that's personal, I mean, post what your personal process is into writing a song, designing a sound, working on a sample, because people love to see that kind of stuff, especially people who aren't producers. producers love to see that, but people who aren't producers love to see that and be like, oh shit, I had no idea that's how you do that. Especially if you're like working on a sound, you show them how to design the sound, and then they hear that in your track, they go, oh shit, I remember watching him on Instagram do that. That's so cool that I can hear what he did there.
Yeah, you have an emotional connection to that song now, which is what gets you, I mean, that's your product. That's what gets you money. That's what you get. That's how you get paid, and that's how you get famous. That's definitely what you're trying to do. Success right there.
I would say the best platform to be on is Instagram. I've tried Twitter. Twitter is just full of SJWs at this point. That's all it is. It's just an echo chamber for politics. And Facebook, like you said, it's difficult to get in the algorithm in the right way. And we'll talk about that in just a second. But the place to be to get the biggest following, to get people looking at you and caring about you and your brand and your artistry, Instagram's just the perfect place to be. And people like to see images and videos more than they like to read words. It's easier, they consume it faster.
So let's just divide the goals in three, right? One's growth, one's development, and the other one is maintenance. That's how I think of it, right? So growth, we created our content, we determine who's our audience, we cleaned everything up, looks good. Then development is we make those relationships, we keep it engaged, we start following people, we start going to the hashtags and commenting on posts and making sure people come back to us. And then the last one is maintenance for me. And that's, if I generated an audience, like, you know, say over 2,000 people, they're following you, you got to keep them interested. You can't just grow and be like, oh, I don't have to post anything this week. I don't have to do anything anymore. Like, this is, you gain them as fast as you lose them. Make sure your content is still relevant. You're still staying on top of it. You're still talking to the people that talk. You'll probably get more comments and more stuff that people come to you now. In a way, it's easier because maybe you don't have to do 81 comments anymore on hashtags. Maybe it's 20 on hashtags and then 75 on your own personal timeline or on your DMs or whatever. But it's all about nurturing those relationships. And when you have people reaching out to you, that's way easier to throw a pitch of like, oh, you should check out my website, or, you know, I do this stuff. So if you ever need,
like, listen to this track or share it. Yeah.
Right. If you ever need mastering or mixing or whatever, like, hit me up, dude. I would love to work with you. But it's less force than you just liking somebody's post in the end and then like, your band, let's work together tomorrow, you know? Like, they don't care. People get that all the time. They just don't care.
Yeah, it just doesn't work. And it's totally true that you'll get, once you're tailoring the content to your audience that you've been strategically working on and designing to come and follow you, once you start creating content for that audience, it's crazy how quickly they'll start to comment on things that they weren't commenting on before. I've got this guy on Instagram that followed me way back in, like, he started following me before I had 100 likes, maybe even 150. And this was probably back in November or October that he started following me. Never commented on anything, would occasionally like some things. And now that I've adjusted my brand, he's a producer. Now that I've adjusted my brand to these tips and tricks I'm giving out and advice, he's starting to comment on things. He's starting to give his opinion, and he's starting to actually care and take value in the things that I'm talking about and the information that I'm giving away.
Yeah. I mean, you're motivating your users to engage. I did some experiments as I was growing this stuff because my stuff started growing crazy. Like, right now I'm at 4,800 followers. On Thanksgiving, I was right under 900. So we're talking in a span of 6-7 months, I quadrupled what I had. So I did some experiments where I'll take pictures that I posted maybe 2 years ago or a year ago, repost it, exact same thing, and see what happens. Or like, okay, let's add some tags that are more relevant to this post. And immediately the engagement was more. And it was because of multiple things. The first one was because I was getting more followers and posting better content, the Instagram monster was happy, so I was being more relevant. So I was reaching the right people that wanted to talk to me. Versus before, I'm sure like 7% of my followers were watching it. I was like, okay, cool, here's a, you know, 1176 meter, next.
The biggest question that I see from producers the most about branding is the, well, what kind of content should I be creating? It's the number one question, but just remember, you got to start with your audience. You got to build your, who is your audience? Just start there and look at what they're,
and what
like.
What they like.
Yeah, what do they like? What are they engaging
and
in?
And you kind of have to control them. And it's almost like manipulating them to see you. For example, for me to get mastering gigs, my thought process is I need to get producers and I need to get artists that are more tech savvy and are going to record and mix their own song, right? So those guys are going to like gear pictures and they're going to like speakers and they're going to, you know, like plug-in settings and stuff like that. So if I pose that way, I attract those people, and the more people that, like that I attract, the more business I get. If I was just going to go straight for artists and I was still recording, that approach would be horrible. Because the people that are looking at that are already in the studio and they don't care. Or they'll like my stuff because it looks pretty, but they're not going to contact me to work.
For me, it's I'm looking for producers who are either struggling with their mixdowns or need someone to master their track. And for my niche, for electronic music, producers are looking for things that are going to teach them to be a better producer. They want to see someone who knows what they're doing, they're knowledgeable in the things that they do, and they know what they're talking about. The amount of saves that I get on my post, every single post is getting at least 10 saves. That doesn't sound a lot, but one of my recent posts, I think it was last week or 2 weeks ago, my biggest one that got over 200 likes, it had over like 130 saves. And what that tells me is people, first of all, when they're in the studio, they want to look back at that so they can remember what they need to do and work on. They could potentially follow me once they go to their saved posts, read it and go, fuck, that really helped me. I need to be on top of this guy's stuff. And if they come back to me in 2 months, guess what? I have 2 months more worth of content for them to consume.
Right. I mean, you're providing value at that point. And that's the other thing. How do you measure it? Well, look at your insights. Turn your profile into a business profile. It's super easy. Just Google it. The first rule of being an entrepreneur, figure it the fuck out. And you'll have so many insights where you can start seeing, like, what does your audience like? Who is your audience? You know, what cities you're being followed. And if you're combining this with Facebook ads or whatever else you're doing, you have a very narrow targeted audience that you can say, oh, I don't know, people like, for example, my biggest audiences are in Mexico City and New York City. So I could be like, oh, I could hit New York City bands. And there's a bigger chance they'll know who I am than me just shooting all over the U.S. and somebody in Wyoming being like, who is this guy?
You know? Right, right. And that's a big thing, too, is you can localize things for a producer. You're going to be looking for DJ gigs in your city. You're not going to be, I mean, if you're in Portland, you're not looking for a DJ gig in New York. Sure, you might be, and you would love that, and it would be great. But if you're a small producer, that's not what you're going to get. So you can kind of localize your area. If you're in Portland and you want to run ads to gather a following, you want to build that community. You want to build your trust in your fan base within your community so you could start running ads for. If you have a new release coming out, you can run an ad for that release in Portland. Get that community to follow you. Because then you can go to promoters and be like, look at all of, you could show them your analytics and be like, look at all of these people interacting with me in Portland. One post that I'm playing a show here and I'll get 100 people here. That's fucking huge. That is how you get a show.
Or the opposite could happen too, you know, where nobody gives a shit about you in Portland, but maybe they do a couple states over. And you have a big following where it's like, I'll drive for 4 hours and I can put up a show there with 30, 40 people versus staying here and having me play to my mom.
You don't know where those people are without these insights. That's why you need this business profile. And you can start looking at, okay, I've got a big following in this city. What are the venues in this city? Who are the club owners? Who are the promoters? How do I get in contact with those people to show them this following I have? Because they might have an opening gig in 3 months that, one, they can pay you for, two, they can pay for your travel. Now you're good to go.
And the other thing is you're not reinventing the wheel, you know? The only things that have changed is the mediums through what we do stuff. But if you do some homework on how people have done it back in the day, like a good example is Fall Out Boy. Fall Out Boy, Patrick, the singer, was amazing at writing songs, but he knew shit about how to market his band. And Pete, the bass player, he was a wizard of MySpace, and he started making friends in MySpace and pushing his band harder before, when, you know, nobody was doing this back in the day there. And he blew it up there to the point where the labels were looking at it like, oh, shit, these guys have a following. And all it took was him figuring that out, like, oh, how can I grow my brand in here? That's what we're doing. Instagram is making it super easy for you. Maybe you find something else, but find the equivalent of Johnny Minardi. I don't know if you know this dude, but so he made a label back in the day called Feel by Ramen. They signed Paramore, Fall Out Boy, Panic at the Disco. Like, he was A&R that did all that stuff, right? One of the things that they will do is, like, he will get test markets with Best Buy, right? Best Buy was buying CDs at that point. That's where you will go and get your CD. So they'll say, oh, I have this band from, you know, insert town here, like whatever your town is. Let's say is Austin, Texas, right? So there's maybe two or three Best Buys here. So they tell you, you know what, we're going to send 30 CDs over there. And if they sell and they do good, we'll sell them nationally. So he'll be like, cool, do that. And then you send your friends with your money to buy those 30 CDs. So Best Buy is like, holy shit, you know, you empty the shelves. It's going everywhere. And now you've grown your brand. Like, now people can access your CD anywhere. So now figure that out in modern times. Nobody's buying CDs.
Yeah. You got to figure that out with streaming. Streaming's a huge thing now. I mean, especially within electronic music, it's all about streaming. And the record labels are starting to realize that. Even licensing, too. That can be a whole nother episode that we'll do later. But this is kind of following into the next step. How do you beat those algorithms to figure out the process on those social media sites like Instagram? For Instagram, I mean, I feel like it's always changing. Are there some resources you go to figure out what's new in the algorithms and what's going to work?
Yes. So stuff is constantly changing. They tend to be good and announce what's happening, but the easiest thing to do is just Google it. Every couple months, something will happen. Your shit, you know, will change. Your strategy will be ruined and you have to figure it out again.
The benefit to, if you're having to restart after a couple months, hopefully you've doubled your following by then. So at least you're starting at a better pace than you were before.
Yeah, definitely. And it's more about how you think of it than it is about a set of rules that you do. Like, for example, people were using a lot of the follow and unfollow software. Instagram has gotten really good in the past couple months where it detects those kind of repetitive tasks and it sends you like a spam warning, like, hey, you know, you shouldn't be doing this. And now they're to the point where they're going to remove likes that were done that way. But if you think of like Facebook, it's a great example. Back in the day, people were buying likes because the person that had the more of the likes was, you know, the best artists in the world. And then overnight they shifted to where you would only 10% of people that like that page will see the whatever you're posting unless you're paying for it. So all the people that bought those likes got screwed because now you're just pretty much advertising or sending stuff to just ghost pages.
Yeah, that aren't going to engage at all. And now you're not even in the algorithm at all.
Right. So that's why you should work with the algorithm in a way that it is, you know, they're not going to change the motto of the company or the main process of the company. Like, here's another example. And that's something that I wanted to talk to you about your post lately. So Instagram is all about visuals, right? They hate text.
Ah.
To the point where if you try to promote one of your posts, I guarantee they're not going to allow it because it has too much text.
Oh, shit.
And here's what you need to prepare for and how you do it. You usually have a picture of a plugin, right? Or, you know, whatever it is, and then the information on it. Instagram lets you do a post with multiple pages where you can scroll, right? Multiple pictures. So if your first picture is just a plugin, number one, the image recognition algorithm is going to look at that and say, oh, people like this kind of stuff. The next thing is it's easier to see it on different kinds of phones and tablets and whatnot. Like, when you're on a tablet, it's easy to read what you post. When you're on a small phone, like some broke artists that are still on like an iPhone 6 or whatever, like, it's impossible to read that little stuff, you know? And the biggest thing is, what if, like, right now you're at the stage of growth, right? So you're still figuring out your blueprint. So what if a post of yours does really good and overnight you get 300 likes and you get, you know, 50 saves? At that point, you should be like, oh, I should invest and maybe throw $10 at this post to promote it, right? Well, you can't because they're not going to let you because you have text. So you kind of have to figure out those rules. And we know that Instagram is not going to change that because that's their motto. It's a visual app.
Yeah, definitely.
Kind of set yourself for success. Figure a way where the information is there for who wants to read the information. The plugin settings are there for whoever just wants to look at pretty plugins. And it's easy for you. It's one click away to say, this is successful. Let's take it to the next level, you know?
Damn, dude, dropping some knowledge right on the show. I love it. Learning. No, it's funny you mentioned that because there's lots of posts I am seeing producers, engineers and whatnot, and they're posting tips and stuff. And a lot of what they're doing is they have an image of whatever it is they're talking about, but then in their caption, it's all the information that you need to read up on. And like you said, it's in a good size font too for whatever phone you're using so that you don't have to zoom in and try to read everything and then it gets fucked up and then eventually people go, fuck this, and just swipe up and ignore whatever was posted. So that's a huge, yeah, I think that's big. I think the slider thing could be a big thing too.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, because you can do one of your posts could be like four slides,
yeah,
you know?
And a tip on each one, big lettering, and the first image is just whatever it is I'm going to be talking about.
And each, you know, whatever social media you pick is going to have their own set of rules. Like, same thing doesn't apply for Facebook, maybe. Like, Facebook does look like big pictures with other stuff. Or Twitter has so many characters, so you won't be able to do that stuff. Or just figure out what works for you and cater to that. Like, follow the rules of the game so your shit becomes relevant.
And can you give some advice and tips on, and this is going to be, I mean, if you're listening to this right now in 6 months, this episode, I think, is going to be coming out next week, the first week of June. So if you're listening to this in December, it's going to be completely different. But for you people that are listening now, you'll get a little bit of advice you can start working on. What are some tips that they can do to beat the algorithm? I know this is not going to change at all, one of these. If you're listening to this in December, it's still going to be true today. It was true a year ago, and it will continue to be true. The first one that I'll start with is consistency. You got to set up a schedule for when you're posting. With producers, you might not have enough content to consistently post every single day or every other day. I would recommend maybe posting once or twice a week. Just work within that. If you have some personal stuff you want to talk about, maybe there's a process you want to show, it might be even more valuable to post that in your stories. For me, I post Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and I post between 5 p.m. Actually, it's usually between 6 p.m. and about 7:30 p.m. And the reason for that is people see me every Monday, Wednesday, Friday. They see my post at the exact same time. I'm always in there. Feed at the exact same time, and people like that recognition, that consistency. They know if they come to their feed at this time, I'll have a new post for them to learn about. So that's a huge one. But what are some other things that people can work on right now to work within that algorithm?
Good looking content. So think how you can make your stuff look good. Like, for example, you want to share a plugin and you want to write something about it. Don't just put out your phone and take a picture of your screen. It degrades the image so much. And then Instagram, you know, is going to degrade it even more. Think of it as like...
And their algorithm's not going to like that either.
Right. Take a screenshot and email it to yourself and post something that looks good. Because also phones get bigger, resolutions get bigger. Make sure that, you know, a year down the line is going to look good.
The best website that I can recommend to anyone that's going to be creating Instagram posts and you want something that's high quality, it's got the perfect dimensions and a lot of awesome tools that you can use for free is Canva.com. Canva.com. Do you use Canva for your posts at all?
I have used it before. I haven't used it in a while, to be honest.
They've got dimensions for posts for each social media site. Every single one of my posts that you're seeing right now is made on Canva, and I guarantee it will continue to be made on Canva because they've got a lot of awesome options for me to use. It's free, it's quick. I highly recommend that for creating some new stuff. But quality is huge. That goes right into the algorithm. What are some other things that they can do?
Make sure that the stuff you post is relevant and not just to the time. You'll have really good content and then it gets clouded if you start posting a lot of dumb stuff around it. I think that's what like stories are for.
Sense.
Yeah. Or like, for example, if you do, you know, you post like what I post, like there's pictures of my studio, pictures of this, you know, song I've been working on and whatever. I go to shows, and if I start posting videos of me at the show, they usually look pretty shot. Those posts that were doing good are going to get buried between all the shitty pictures taken in the middle of a night in a nightclub that makes no sense, you know.
If you're playing a show, if you take out your phone, record the crowd, put that in your story. Don't post that. If you have a photographer that takes a great fucking video and produces it, post that shit, obviously. If it's just a phone recording, you can take 10 recordings in the hour that you're, every 10 minutes, you can take a recording of the crowd of a new track that's being played, post that in your story. Now you've got 10 stories lined up for people to flip through, and it's an actual story because they're following this play-by-play of your show, which is fun. It's interactive. They see this crowd. People hear these tracks that they really like, and you can even throw hashtags on there so other people who are going through stories can find that kind of stuff.
Another thing I learned from working with Machine was he used to call this DJ marketing, and basically he stole it from the EDM world. In the EDM world, from what I understand, you guys love to do collaborations, right?
Oh, yes.
So a very unknown artist gets DJ whoever, Khalid, for example, Scream on my track.
Not Khalid. Yeah.
But like Scream Your Name on my track a couple times, right? And now I have a song with Khalid, and you immediately get the plays that he would get. So that's what we call DJ marketing. And as producers, that's your strongest suit because, for example, a band that I work with, right? Like, I don't know, like Crobat or Clutch, whoever. If I do a post and I tag them in it, my name is attached to them. And because we did something together and I'm sharing something about what we did together, fans of those people are going to get my stuff. And so it's important that's like good content for the people that follow you. But at the same time, it kind of allows you to be exposed by those people.
If you're opening up a show for a big name artist that people are coming out to see, post the show in your stories, record the crowd and post it in your stories and tag that artist. One, they might see your stuff, they might follow you, hear your tracks, and then they want to collaborate with you, which is taking it a step further. Now you're getting more exposed to their market and their audience. Not only that, exactly what Alberto is saying here is if you're tagging them in your stuff, their fans are going to be looking at that and they might start following you. It opens you up to just so many more opportunities if you're working with these people, whether they know you or not, and you're on a show, you're on a lineup with them. To be tagging them in these posts is huge for you.
And I mean, people like content, you know, this is free content for a lot of them. Same with companies, like audio software companies love this stuff, you know. Make a post about you using whatever, the new compressor that this company likes. Say, how good is it, Waves? You killed it. And Waves is probably going to look at that and be like, you know what, repost. And that's how you get their traffic to your site.
They could go even further than that. I mean, actually, and this isn't even so much so about exposing you to their market, but you never know if Wave sees something that they really like from you and they notice that you're getting a bigger following. And you don't know when they're watching you. Let's say they are watching you. There's a huge potential that they might send you free stuff, free gear, free plugins, and you can review. Yeah.
Especially plugins.
Oh, yeah. And now, next thing you know, you get an entire Waves bundle that is normally $300, $400, $500. You didn't have to spend a penny on it. And maybe they just ask you to shout out Waves in a couple of posts. You got a bunch of free plugins for you to fuck around with and develop new stuff with just for marketing purposes. They want you to tag them and stuff, then they might start reposting even more from you. Now you're opening yourself up into their audience and their market.
Right. And I mean, you're literally attaching your name to theirs, which is what you want, you know.
So if you want to be within the algorithm and get those brownie points for you to be posted in more feeds, you want to be consistent. You need to have high quality images.
Making your stories. So your stories kind of feed your profile. It'll feed, you know, its activity. The algorithm sees that and says, hey, this person is active. You should be following him. And the other thing about stories that we didn't mention is if somebody's constantly following you and like looking at your profile, you know, and engaging with you, every time you go live or you do a story, they get a notification. So you're top of mind constantly. So that's the beauty of stories. You know, if you don't have content that it's going to be relevant in a month or 2 months, put it in your story.
If you have a post from like 3 or 4 months ago that you want to reshare, put it in your story. You don't have to, you know, don't post it in your feed again, because then people will start seeing duplicate stuff and they don't like that. And the algorithm definitely won't like it. But you, I mean, post it in your story. Your stories are there for exactly what it's called, your story. Talk about your process, show things that you wouldn't post on your normal feed, and people just get a little bit more of an insight into who you are, what you're doing, and they like that. They like to see that kind of thing. A story is very non-intrusive. They have to go to you to get that insight, whereas if you're posting something irrelevant and personal to you in a feed and they're scrolling and that interrupts them and it's something they don't care about, they don't like to see that. They want to see that in your story where they can check it whenever they want and it's not just being blasted in their face and it's very interruptive. The fourth thing we can talk about is hashtags. How should you be approaching hashtags?
Oh, yeah. 'Cause
that's something that's always changing, and I see so many people doing it the wrong way now.
I mean, there's so many misconceptions about them. I remember when they started, like, you could get these apps that give you the top hashtags, and you will just throw those hashtags in there and get likes out of nowhere, you know? I feel like now they're more curated, and if you're, let's call it a poser, if you're tagging YOLO and you're not just jumping out of a parachute, like, I don't want to see that in there.
This goes into being consistent and tailoring to your audience. What you're putting in your hashtags should apply to your image.
So from what I've read lately, they wanted in the first comment, do 5 to 10 hashtags that are very relevant to what you're doing, right? Study those hashtags, like click on them before you post them, just click on them and see what kind of content is there. Like, I remember one time you hit me up like, oh, you're trending. I'm like, they come up very often, but it's because I use hashtags that match my content perfectly. And I avoid the ones, like, I've been learning some that I just like, well, sure, it's cool, but, you know, I'm never going to get anywhere on new music with hashtags.
I think the other thing, too, is, you know, don't be posting the exact same hashtags every single post. You don't want to have the exact same 5 to 10 hashtags every single time you're posting, because that'll show up in the algorithm as spam. If it's the same fucking thing every single time.
And that's what you're fighting now, the spam.
Yeah. If you're looped in with that spam, then that's what you're considered on Instagram, and then you're not being shown to the people that you want to be shown to or that you should be shown to.
Stay engaged. The new algorithm, it basically wants you to see doing stuff. You know, the more time you're on Instagram, the happier it is.
Interact and comment on people's stuff. Like
commenting, liking, just...
Yep. And sincere commenting. Don't fucking just post this like your beat. Or like your stuff. Don't say like your stuff, because that will show up in the algorithm as a bot. You can tell if a fucking bot is commenting on your stuff because it's not relevant at all to what you're posting. And that happens to me all the time. It's funny how people just don't catch on to how those don't. That doesn't. I don't know a single person that has seen that and been like, yes, I'm going to talk to you. It's
the worst part is a lot of times I go check it just to see what it is, you know, because maybe there's a diamond in the rough there. Because let me tell you, I've had encounters like that where it's like, oh, these guys are coming in really strong, and it's just some dude where English is his second language and he has no idea how to say, like, hey, this is my band, you know, like, he doesn't know the social rules of Instagram that we have in the US. So for them it's just like, oh, I'm sharing stuff, you know, you like stuff, me like.
Yeah, that's a good point. I never really thought about it that way. Most of the time I look at those pages and it's just some fucking promo bot page that they've created for
someone. If he has to fire emojis after check out my song, not gonna be good.
Get the fuck out of here. So we've got, you want to be consistent, how many times you're posting, when you're posting is a big one too.
Quality.
Then we've got your stories.
Follow the rules of the app. You know, if it's a visual app, do visual stuff and keep the text where they want the text and keep content, the stories, or where they want the stories or the type of stories they want. Because the more you work with the apps, every time it gets developed, it's going to be better for you. If you try to go against the grain, it's just, you might have success for a month or two, but then the next update, you're going to be kicked out and you're going to be scrambling.
The last thing would be hashtags is, you know, what... Make your hashtags relevant to your post. 5 to 10, make sure those hashtags are the first comment on your post. Don't duplicate those comment or those hashtags every single post. You know, maybe do it every other post or every two posts. You can use the same hashtag. As long as it's relevant, just make sure it's relevant with that post. and you'll be good to go.
All these social media platforms are the tech industry, and the tech industry loves to blog about itself. So just Google it every couple of months, like, oh, what's up with the Instagram algorithm 2019? And like, just look at stuff that was written from May to June or July or whatever, like, you know, the past 2 months. Figure out what it says and just keep working with that. These guys go in detail, and a lot of them really explain it in layman terms where, you know, you're like, oh, this is relevant to me, or like, this won't even matter for me.
Just think of your profile as, this is how they're doing this with their algorithm. They're grading you. You're on a, whatever that grade is, whatever that scale is, whether it's numbered or anything, they're grading you based on your content. So just every time you're going to post something or you're planning to post stuff, just really think about what it is that you're posting, how you're going about it, and are you working within their rules in their platform? Because, remember, you're on their turf. You have to work within their rules. Otherwise, you're going to get knocked down a grade and you won't be shown up as much as you should be. I think that's about it, Alberto. Do you have any closing things you want to quickly talk about? Or how about, obviously plug yourself.
I think we cover everything, but yeah, you can find me at albertomixes.com. Pretty easy.
Yeah, you're not really mixing electronic music, but if you need mastering, man, Alberto is a great mastering engineer. I've heard some of his stuff on EDM. So yeah, if you guys want a good master from him, do you do free sample masters as well?
Yeah, I do test masters. I usually do a song or send them a chorus or whatever they want, and we go from there.
Mm-hmm. And what was your website again?
It's albertomixes.com.
All right, perfect. Sweet. Anything else you want to plug?
No, man, I'm good.
Awesome. Thank you so much, right. Alberto. I appreciate you taking the time. All right, take care.
All right, you too.
Thanks so much for tuning in again, guys. I would really appreciate it if you would head on over to Apple Podcasts and leave a rating, a review, and subscribe to the podcast. Don't forget to share it with your friends. Head on over to enviousaudio.com/podcast to check out the show notes. I'd also like to hear from you. What do you want to get out of this show? What would you like me to talk about? Who would you like me to have on as guests? Send your emails in to podcast@enviousaudio.com. Let me know what you think of the show. If you want me to bring on a specific guest or talk about a specific topic, I'd love to. And I'll see you guys next time.